everyone. I hope you're doing well. Thank you for tuning in, because this is an experiment, and this is going to be my reaction to Demon Slayer season 7. No, that's MHA season 4, episode 2. I don't know stuff, okay? Demon Slayer is one of those ones where, like, the movies aren't just side stories, the movies are actually part of the plot. So you gotta remember, like, which movie was actually season 2. So, we're gonna watch, yeah, season 4, episode 2. Me not knowing the order of the episodes or the order of the seasons does not change my love of the show. I still love the show, and I still love the story, and it still deserves all of the recognition. Last we left off, Giyome is proposing this insanely harsh, like, Hashira training in order to get people to manifest marks. And, I mean, but according to Moichiro, if your body can maintain 39 degrees Celsius and you don't die, you could manifest the mark. Which makes me think that if any of these Demon Slayers actually manage to reach 39 degrees, they might just die already. Not to mention, people who manifest the marks might have something happen to them, something special or something interesting, because Amane cut herself off at the exact moment that she told everyone, so no one knows! I know, I'm a manga reader. Let's get into this. Yushiro?
Oh.
What?
Konbanwa,
oh, he immediately sensed that something was off. He's gonna kill the crow the moment he gets in. That crow has awareness in its eyes, specifically because it has human Sanemi looking eyes. But like, that's Ubuyashiki's bird. Ubuyashiki? Is that it? Ubuyashiki? Easy, Dick, easy. Will that bird be gone by the time that Yushiro gets there? Again, that is all you had to say. She hates him. That was a beautiful just pull away shot there. Oh my gosh. Oh! Okay. In the manga, you forget those things happen at night. Anything. The Demon Slayer Corps have received a powerful, powerful ally in Lady Tamayu. Y'all don't know. Oh my gosh, look at Sanemi. Like, they've got everybody there, and Sanemi's just like... So, that's interesting. Because the only demon that has pink eyes in this is Nezuko. And there's a mark engraved into her eyeballs. The only people who have that are the upper moons. And the lower moons, but they're dead now. So what does that mean? Does it just mean that Muzan has his sights set on her? Technically, his eyes are kind of... No, they're red. They're red. He looks so much more menacing lately than he did in season 1. How are your injuries? He says. Look at him. Of course. He cares so much. He cares. Now you know that Tanjiro is gonna just keep doing that without end. Is she going to guess that it's Tomioka? Oh, absolutely. She's gonna give him extra food. Oh, that's sweet. Well, it's Giyu. The man is like the surface of water, just completely calm. Oh, goodness. Sumimasen! He's going to throw open the door, yep, and be like, nope, I'm here. It's adorable. Probably, you're probably annoying him. Oh. Oh. New meaning. That is what people with black swords do, right? They're unable to find...
Shouldn't say that. 水柱が不在?
Giyu-san がいるじゃないですか。
水柱じゃない。
It will be an unending torrent unless you open up to him. Oh, this is adorable. Like, look, he hasn't even slept. Tanjiro! He's like, oh my gosh. How can you say no to a face like that? Just talk to him. Okay. Look at his hair. Oh, yeah. Imagine that, right? Come on, you had to have noticed. Sabito's Haori is exactly the same as Giyu's. Oh, that hand demon. Oh my gosh. Ew. So that hand demon really only cared about Orochimaru's students.
Yeah. Oh.
Well, Aoi did that. She was terrified. I'm sorry, you knelt before the master and you defeated enough demons to become a Hashira. Aoi has a place in the Demon Slayer Corps and she doesn't even fight. Oh, and you're so sure. This is far from denial. Tanjiro, chase after him now and slap him? Yes, very much so. Of course, every single day. Well, I don't think he had that. Oh no, Rengoku! I'm sorry, I'm thinking about his family. That's right. But is Giyu gonna believe that? I don't think so. Of course. But that does not make Giyu any less. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, something like that. Because life doesn't struggle and grieve along with you. Of course.
Oh gosh.
I'm sorry, so wait a minute. They just went to a shop. She's mad. You're moving up the ranks, aren't you? Oh yeah. That's cute.
Oh my gosh,
that outro. How sinister. Is that Muzan? Oh yeah, it is. I can see the patterns on his vest. Is this ending from Muzan's point of view? Okay, I needed to organize my thoughts just a teensy bit. Let's start with what happened first. I'm gonna kind of skip over the Tomioka and Yushiro stuff because that's basically already been explained. Lady Tamayo is going to come and work with Shinobu to possibly defeat Muzan Kibutsuji. Looks like Shinobu's not okay with that. I don't know why she would be mad so much about that. Only immatures lose control of their emotions, but she's always been sort of angry behind a smile. That's kind of been her whole, like, personality and facade. I imagine she's mad about being, about wanting to work with Lady Tamayo. I don't see any other reason, unless, of course, something else is happening that I just, that slipped my mind, I don't remember. But let's talk about first, is it Ubuyashiki or Ubuyashiki? I need to know how to pronounce his name, because he shares my third favorite character spot with Tanjiro. I have never known a more selfless person in anime as Kaguya Ubuyashiki, the man who leads the Demon Slayer Corps, the man who thinks of others and thinks for others, and never once thinks about himself. He is in the worst possible condition right now. He cannot move, he cannot see, and it's obvious that this progression of this disease will at some point grow to cover him completely. It's like the man has a terminal disease, but he doesn't once care about himself or his well-being. He only wishes to comfort other people. And he only worries after other people. The other Hashira are doing their training, and he immediately reaches out to Tanjiro and is like, hey, I need you to talk to Giyu for me. The first thing he says is, how are your injuries, Tanjiro? And then he only says, like, that I'm unable to move. He only says that as an explanation for why he can't go talk to Giyu himself. So he asks Tanjiro to do it because they both studied under Uro Kodaki, because Giyu was so ready to commit seppuku for Nezuko. And I mean, now we know why he's so willing to commit seppuku for Nezuko. I mean, the man had a death wish. He truly thinks that he's not worthy. And I think that's what's going on. Like, Giyu says, I'm different from them. He barely passed final selection. Again, Aoi is another person who also barely passed final selection. She was not brave enough to continue fighting. So Shinobu took her in and basically gave her authority over the Shinobu estate, the Kocho estate. So she's still helping out the Demon Slayers. Now, Giyu put in the work, put in the training to become a Hashira. But from the moment that his sister died for him, recovered, and then Sabito died for him too, let's be honest, Sabito saved him and then went off to try to rescue somebody else and then got killed. Basically, Giyu is now like, I'm not worthy anymore. He keeps saying, I'm different from you guys. And of course, Sanemi takes that to mean, wait a second, you think you're better than me? Come on now, that's not what I like to hear. But that's not what it is, and it never has been. Giyu doesn't think he's worthy. He's not worthy of being the Water Hashira. Or at least he's so deep in denial that he's like, no, I like, at first, when I read the manga and I read, I am not the Water Hashira, I was like, okay, what kind of psychological denial is this? Like, what exactly makes you think that you're not the Water Hashira? Because you very obviously are. You are one of the 9 Hashira, and you're obviously apart from everybody, but that doesn't mean, like, that doesn't mean jack. You're still a Hashira. But no, it's not that Giyu doesn't think that he's a Water Hashira. He thinks he is not worthy, and it is a deep-seated self-hatred, one that persisted even before he and Sabito became friends. Let's talk about Rengoku. Rengoku gave his life up in the best possible way, defending Tanjiro and Zenitsu and Inosuke and everybody on that train from one of the most powerful demons to ever live. I know there are a bunch of people out there in the world who hate Akaza because of what he did to Rengoku, because of the amazing warrior that definitely would have manifested a mark if he was still alive at this time, because he had the potential. He had a red blade, a sunlit blade. Of course the dude would have manifested a mark. A shining beacon of hope is what Rengoku was. And Akaza squashed it. Akaza killed him. He went out in the most honorable way possible, but Akaza still killed him. And as epic and as fearful and as formidable as Akaza is, there is something that stands out to me here, specifically for this episode. He said, I despise weak people. I despise weak people. but I'll fight you, Rengoku, because I can tell you're strong. The thing is that Akaza's words got through to Tanjiro. Because when Rengoku died, Tanjiro considered himself worthless. There was a moment when Tanjiro was like, why is it that every single time I think I've cleared a wall, there's another wall? Why did Rengoku sacrifice himself for someone who is much weaker than him? He probably thought, I'm nothing, I'm nobody. Why did Rengoku save me? Why did he have to die? Tanjiro was feeling worthless, which is exactly how Giyu has been feeling this entire time. I mean, honestly, I feel like that might come back in some way. That has to come around. Akaza might not have been there when Sabito sacrificed himself for Giyu, but that is almost the exact same moment that Giyu had to witness. Giyu was hurt badly, like very, very bad head wound, just like Tanjiro, who had a very, very bad abdomen wound, stuck, unable to do anything, watching as his best friend, his respected best friend, went off to fight a near impossible foe, died. Rengoku is to Tanjiro what Sabito is to Giyu, a strong protector, and honestly a sacrificial sort of figure, a sacrificial mentor figure. So of course Tanjiro knows exactly how Giyu feels. And the thing is that Giyu can claim. He can claim that he had forgotten about what Sabito said to him. About how when Sabito said, no, you gotta live for your sister who died. Try as he might to claim that Giyu doesn't remember that, yes he does. Because his haori is Sabito and his sister. He carries them and their lives, their aspirations, he carries them with him. Unbeknownst to his own self-loathing and denial and feeling of worthlessness. Giyu, come on, wake up. Wake up, they're there. They've always been there. And all Tanjiro needed to do is to basically say, hey, are you really gonna turn your back on what you think Sabito's entrusted you with? Because Rengoku entrusted so much to me. That whole set your heart ablaze thing. And that whole thing about how time will not grieve with you or coddle you when you are in the throes of your own despair. Time is of the essence now more than ever, Giyu. Get out of your funk and start training. So there's that. Sorry, that took a very long time. But I feel like Giyu really needed to sort of turn around and be serious. The fact that Kanao is making more decisions and how Shinobu basically went, okay, you're ready now. But this is like, not initiation, but like, this is like the first step of being an adult sort of thing, like a coming of age sort of thing. Because now it's like Shinobu has almost accepted Kanao into her family. Kanao wears the little butterfly hair clips. I might be completely incorrect on this, and that's why I feel like I can say it out loud, is the fact that I think Kanao has Kanai's hairpins. I feel like Shinobu has basically realized, wow, Kanao has actually grown up. She's learned to make decisions for herself. And I feel like that deserves some kind of reward. At this point, Kanao feels less like Shinobu's ward / apprentice, and more like Shinobu's little sister. Kanai and Shinobu bought Kanao when she was very young. So it's not like Kanao went to Shinobu and said, let me learn from you. She kind of became a Kocho. Her name is Kanao Tsuyuri. She does have a different last name, but she's practically a Kocho at this point. Like, honestly, I feel like her and Shinobu are family. They are the only things that they that each other has left, because I feel like they both have the shared grief of Kanai dying. I don't think anybody else in Demon Slayer has that same sort of bond. Is that they were both very close to a specific character, and that character died, and that singular death bound them as family members. Like Rengoku and his little brother, who he was training. And the fact that that initiation, that like family secret is, I'm gonna teach you how to kill the demon that killed my sister. I mean, come on, that's so hardcore, that's so cool. And I love the implications. All of this episode and the things that it implied and the things that it set up for later on with Ubu Yashiki, with Giyu, with Shinobu, with Kanao, with anyone really, with Tamayo, especially with Tamayo and Shinobu and what that might look like in the future. I can't wait for the next episode. I feel like I'm watching this as an anime only, where things are coming back to me as I'm watching them, and I'm not expecting anything from this arc, and I love that very much. So yeah, be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. Ding the bell for notifications. You don't have to, but it would be super, super cool if you did. Comment below, tell me your theories, tell me your analyses, tell me everything. I'll definitely put like a manga spoiler comment thing in the comments so that we can scream about what this means. But yeah, thank you so much for staying, and have a nice day.